This is the Fox 5 Rev Zone Sports Show, presented by RC Willie. Your home, your way.
Good evening and welcome to the final Rev Zone of the season. Kevin Bolinger alongside Running Rebels head coach Marvin Menzies. After UNLV finishes with a 20-win season, a 9-win improvement over last year, and coach, I know things just wrapped up, but what's your quick evaluation of how things went this season?
Well, you're never satisfied at the end of the year. There's only two teams that are really satisfied, the NIT champion and the NCAA champion. I think that there's always sad locker rooms across the nation in March, and we had one of those last night. So, you know, your first emotion is you feel bad for the guys, especially the seniors that didn't get a chance to play a few more games and make a postseason tournament. But at the end of the day, I think as more time trickles off and reflection settles in, you say, okay, all right, that was okay for that first bump in the progression of where we're headed. So I think right now there's a lot of work to be done. People think the season's over and, you know, I get to go fishing for 3 weeks, and I wish that was the case. But no, there's still a lot to be done. And so our initial thought as a staff and as a players is take a day, take two, and then we start to, you know, figure out how we're going to go right back to work to move the needle going forward.
We're going to talk about the future and what comes next a little later in the show, but first we want to get back to what happened in the Mountain West Tournament. Mm-hmm. We're going to start with Thursday afternoon's game against Reno.
The rubber match between rivals as the Running Rebels and Wolfpack squared off. UNLV made a statement in the first half. Brandon McCoy with the offensive rebound, putback, and foul. Then JoJo Moring all the way down the lane for the scoop shot. And Chris Clyburn gets the bounce on the triple as the Rebs took an early lead. As always, Jordan Caroline was impossible to defend, showing range from outside the arc and inside. UNLV countered, Mooring with the drive and dish to Shakur Justin for the slam and the slap. The steal by Clyburn, and he heads coast to coast for the lay-in. The Rebels were bombing threes and connecting. JoJo knocked down two straight. McCoy gets in on the action from downtown. JoJo again from deep, and Travell Beck gets the trifecta as the Rebels led 39-31 at the half. UNLV extended the lead to 12 on a Beck jumper and McCoy inside bucket. The key swing of the game came just over 2 minutes into the second half when Jordy Johnson picked up his fourth foul. Mooring would pick up his fourth soon after, and UNR went in to strike. Kendall Stevens and Hallis Cook knocked down threes. And when Caroline got this offensive rebound, put back and foul, Reno had come all the way back to take the lead with a 14-4 run. They extended that lead to 8 on this Caleb Martin baseline drive in reverse. The comeback then was on for the Rebs. Johnson drives, he gets the hoop and the harm. On the missed free throw, Justin gets the putback for a 4-point possession. Cody Martin got an and one to go, and the 3-point play pushed the lead back to 7 with 1:28 left. Justin got a putback to cut it to 3 with 48 seconds to go. After UNR missed the front end of a 1-1, UNLV had possession with a chance to tie with 20 to go. With no timeouts, they drained the clock, but they did not get a good look as Mooring took a deep contested 3 that was off the mark. UNR survives and advances 79-74, ending the Rebel season.
We played with more heart. We played with more like a chip on our shoulder. We wanted to come out here and just play for the fans, the coaches, and the two seniors that we had. So, I mean, we gave it all we had. Sadly, we ain't come out the way we wanted to.
So UNLV came out swinging in the first 20 minutes. You go into the locker room at halftime, you had to be happy with what you were seeing on both ends of the floor.
We were. Obviously, we were doing some things the right way because we were making shots and we were getting stops. We were holding them down. I think they were in the high 30s or low 30s even, you know, defensive field goal percentage. So we were happy. But we weren't satisfied because we knew how potent they can be, and they showed that in the second half.
one of the key plays of the game that maybe got overlooked by some people who were watching was when Jordy Johnson picked up his fourth foul.
Yeah.
A little controversially in terms of going for a loose ball. Not long after that, JoJo picks up his fourth foul. Now you have your whole backcourt kind of playing on their heels for the last 15 minutes of the game.
Yeah, I think they didn't do it intentionally, but we stopped taking the fight to them as a result of the foul situation. So, because we were really trying to pick them up full court, take the fight to them, and climb into them and do some things differently that they had not seen. We hadn't played zone for any extensive amount of period the way that we played it, and it was very good for us the first half. But to Eric's credit, I thought that he attacked the zone differently in the second half and made some adjustments. We made some adjustments after that, but then that's when our guys were in foul trouble and it just kind of broke when they got the 8 threes in the second half.
Today's college basketball really is a three-point game, and UNLV struggled from three-point range all throughout the year.
Right.
And I think that this game was kind of a microcosm of that because it shot it well in the first half, 1 of 10 in the second half, and that's kind of the one thing that I guess just couldn't get over the hump.
You know, it is. It is a big emphasis for, I think, to have teams that can attack you inside and out. Unfortunately for us, we didn't have the shooting from the perimeter at the level that was needed to be successful. But then we also stopped defending the perimeter the way we were early in the season. So the ebbs and flows of this season were challenging, to say the least, in terms of what we needed to deal with as a staff to prep these guys moving forward. And a lot of it kept coming back down to the inexperience. Our defense wasn't near what it should have been with the athleticism, but the athleticism is just that. It's not talent until it's educated. And once you educate athleticism, now you have talent. And our guys will be much, much more talented next year.
Well, UNLV did pick up win number 20 on Wednesday when they beat Air Force for the third time this season.
The Runnin' Rebels opened the Mountain West Tournament against ninth-seeded Air Force and made a concerted effort to get inside touches. The feed to McCoy down low. Johnson with the high lob to Justin. Then McCoy gets his own miss right back up for the hoop and the harm. Mooring with another lob to McCoy for two. And late in the half, Johnson drives the lane and dishes to McCoy as UNLV led 37-33 at the break. The Rebs went on a 9-0 run early in the second to extend the lead to 13, capped by Johnson with the steal and heading the other way for the lay-in. Air Force relied on the three to get back in it. Ryan Manning, Jacob Van, and Ryan Swan all connecting. The Falcons also picked up the press, but Jordy slings a half-court pass to McCoy and he throws it down. And Beck fights for the offensive rebound, the putback, and the pass. That would make it 71-63. Air Force rallied again. Lavelle Scotty hits a three and is fouled, and we were headed to overtime. Early in the OT, Air Force took its first lead of the game on this Trevor Lyons three-point play, but the Rebels dug deep. Watch McCoy run the floor and gets the big block. Justin would get the move, and then he would get the bucket and the bump, and the juice capping it off with the slam as UNLV wins a wild one against Air Force, 97-90.
Coach gave us a game plan to follow, and, you know, we just kept reminding each other that we got to get a stop, you know, and we got the stops when we need them.
The guards did a really good job of penetrating and finding the open man, and I feel like me and Shakur was just a good receiver on that end.
So this was a game where UNLV kind of controlled things for a lot of the game. Air Force actually never led until they got into overtime, but their three-point shooting got them back in it late in the game. Your guys did answer the call, though, in overtime, and I think that was something that was important to see.
Well, we needed to win. We had lost five in a row, and we had some tough losses along that journey, and then we had some fights along that journey of that five-game stretch. So we just needed to get a win, you know, and by hook or by crook, we needed to come away with one to regain that feeling. of when we do the right things and winning time, we're successful. We struggled in the regulation in the last few possessions, but then when it came to overtime, the experience that we had gained earlier in the season kicked in. We got stops and we made buckets.
So the season ends with a 20-13 record, and now all eyes turn towards next year, and that work has already begun. Straight ahead in the Red Zone, we're going to talk about the future of the Running Rebels and what's going to be done for next season. Straight ahead.
You're watching the Fox 5 Red Zone Sports Show, presented by RC Willie. Your home, your way.
Welcome back inside the Reb Zone. We're going to talk now about what's ahead for UNLV. You lose Jovan Mooring, you lose Jordy Johnson, and we're unsure of what's going to happen with Brandon McCoy. But other than that, you have a core nucleus of players that are going to be coming back.
Yeah, we're excited about the returning guys. You know, when you're putting your roster together, you have to plan to look at what just occurred and then what needs to be worked on in the offseason, what needs to be added in the way of talent, specific skill sets and things like that that you need now that you've gone through the conference for a full slate and you know what the competition has. So you got to identify that and then go ahead and make your roster fit as you see fit.
Where are you at in terms of recruiting? Because your class kind of coming in is mm-hmm. pretty set right now. There could be a slot or two that's opened up, but you kind of know what you have coming in.
Yeah, we do, but we're still actively recruiting all the time. Even the younger classes, the 2019 and 20 classes, are still very actively involved with recruiting those folks. You got to recruit 2, 3, 4 years out, which I didn't have the opportunity to do when I first got here. So now that I've been here for a couple years, we're heavily involved with guys that we think could really help us. I would say that, you know, we may look at redshirting a guy that's returning next year. It's too early to decide who would redshirt, but you also have another position or two that we may bring in depending on roster changes and things of that nature. So it's a fluid document, you know, and you've got to kind of make your adjustments based on trying to put the best product on the floor next year.
You lose your backcourt. Where are we looking at in terms of the point position? Because it is so crucial, and who is going to step up and run that?
Well, I think we've got two in the program now, and Noah and Amari, that we're looking to, you know, have those guys be heavily involved in that position as of today. If the program would have games tomorrow, those would be our guys. However, you need to think about the years following them as well, because Noah will be a senior and Amari will be a sophomore. So we're probably going to look to try to bring in another point guard at some point, whether we go with a younger guy, whether we look for the 19, whether we look for, you know, another class. It just depends on the recruiting and what's available.
So much was made of the defense this year, and, you know, by your own admission, there were some struggles at the time. Is now in the off season where things emphasize the defensive part of the game as you work with these guys going through?
Well, it's the defensive part of the game, but it's when you're building a program and when you are going through a process of rebuilding, you are going to have weaknesses. You're going to have failures. You're going to have losses, and that is a part of the process. We're not going to have undefeated seasons. We're not just going to go out and have perfect basketball being played. So once you identify those things, you're identifying how to build your foundation. You're identifying how to fix the blemishes so that you can be more successful the very next season, not 5 seasons from now. So we want to be better. We will be better next year. And that's because we've identified some of our vices.
I want to touch on scheduling real quick, because last year you did what you had to do in terms of getting things going.
Right.
As you look at next year's non-conference schedule, do you start scheduling some tougher games here to raise your RPI, to raise those ratings that are going to benefit you come March?
You always want to schedule appropriate to the roster that you have. So we still have a few question marks there, and we are still in the process of putting the schedule together, but we definitely want to upgrade. We always want to move the RPI in the direction where you don't have to win the tournament, the conference tournament, to be an NCAA team. So, but you also have to move your talent level systematically with that. So, and I think that we're doing that, and I think by the returning guys and their experience, the younger guys and their talent, I think that we'll be able to ramp up the schedule a little bit next year for sure.
We're going to step away from basketball for just a moment, and up next in the Red Zone, we sit down with UNLV head football coach Tony Sanchez to talk some spring football. That's in 2 minutes. Stick and stay.
You're watching the Fox 5 Reb Zone Sports Show, presented by RC Willie. Your home, your way.
We're joined now by UNLV head football coach Tony Sanchez. Spring practice is underway for the football team. What have we seen so far here in these first couple of practices, and what are you expecting to see over the next few weeks?
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm really excited. It was good to get back on the field with the guys. You know, it's been a while since the last game, and obviously we had a little bit bitter taste in our mouth, so we're excited to get out there and get back to work. But a lot of familiar faces around. I mean, you know, we were a young team and returned a lot of guys. It's good seeing Armani there, and, you know, that big offensive line, Lex in the running backs field, and having Tim Skipper come over as a new DC and just seeing that energy on that side of the ball. And those guys, they're really engaged. You know, the new defensive staff, with the exception of Coach Shams, has done a really good job of coming on in, you know, bringing a sense of urgency and energy that we need.
How much of a scheme change are we going to see Skipper bring in, and how much of that is installed now and the importance of spring to get that going?
Well, it's huge. I mean, these 15 practices are so, I mean, they're important for the whole team, but really defensively, you get the terminology down, the alignment, the assignment technique, you know, obviously playing hard, and you don't want guys playing slow because they're thinking right now. So we're working through that. But there's some subtle differences. I mean, you're going to, you know, we're going to be in a 40 front. We're going to be in a 3-4 front. So we'll be multiple, but we're just going to take it slow. We just got to be better at the fundamentals, better at just getting lined up right, covering guys, make sure we're doing a better job of tackling, really do a great job of communication. And, you know, we had some breakdowns there at times, and it really hurt us. So I think that, I know that they're going to do a really good job at that.
You're big on competition at every position. I would assume you go into the spring with the mindset of people are competing for starting spots, even if they were a starter last year.
There's no doubt. I mean, you know, one of the first things I mentioned a minute ago was Armani, but Max Gilliam right behind him is doing a great job. I mean, he's been out there, and he's a dealer. I mean, he does a really good job of getting rid of the ball fast, reads defenses. You know, he's had some good experience. Kenny Noblad, one of the local guys, he's doing a really good job. And really, it's all over the place. I mean, and sometimes it's a competition to be that one, and sometimes it's to be that two or three. I mean, you look at the running back spot, and Lexington obviously is earning the right to be that guy. But right behind him, you know, you got Owens, and you got Campbell, Tariq Hollingsworth, you got Charles Williams coming back out. Well, those guys are going to have to fight to get those carries. So there's a lot of spots where there's some good, healthy competition going on.
The schedule came out here recently, and it's really backloaded to be very tough where you're playing your division opponents those last 4 weeks of the season. Your thoughts on the way the schedule sets up?
Yeah, you know, it's a real orderly schedule, so to speak. I mean, you have your 4 preseason games, then you have a bye, then you have your 3 Mountain Division games, and then you end with all of your West Division, which we haven't had that before. So, you know, I don't mind it. Obviously, you know, it's going to be fun week one going down to L.A. I mean, it's a place we heavily recruit, so we're excited about going out and playing SC. And then coming 2 games away at home, and then you have Arkansas State, which is kind of like that Northern Illinois game. It's going to be a great measuring stick. They're a good program, so it's going to be a tough game. I'm excited about that. And then, you know, like you said, going into those mountain games, and I think we got to start off well. I mean, I think there's some wins out there early. Obviously, it's one at a time, but I think there's a lot of opportunity. And if you're going to have a chance down that home stretch, that could be a really fun time to be a player and a Rebel football fan.
So the spring practice all builds up towards the spring game on April 14th, and it's a chance for fans to get out to the soccer field there at noon on that day and see some early indications of what you got.
Absolutely. I mean, it'll be great. You know, this year we actually have practices on Saturdays. We changed that last year. We were Monday, Wednesday, Friday. But we wanted to do the Saturday so people could come on out and, you know, be a part of it. And then the spring game is the culmination of it all. It'll be a fun day. There's always a great event. We always have great crowds, good food, good music, and good football. So it'll be exciting for everyone to come see us.
All right. Can't wait for the fall. Thanks, Coach. Appreciate it. We're back to wrap up the Reb Zone with Coach Menzies and the Runnin' Rebel Plays of the Year right after this.
You're watching the Fox 5 Reb Zone Sports Show, presented by RC Willie. Your home, your way.
We're rejoined now by Marvin Menzies, and just because the season's over doesn't mean the work stops. You guys are right back at it.
You know me well. No, that's true. We're, you know, we've got a lot of stuff and planned right now for the guys. We've given them, we're going to give them a few days off, but we're right back in the gym. We're doing individual skill development. We will take all of the film of every minute that the guys have played in practice and in games and identify weaknesses and strengths and go back to make them better players and help them to be able to contribute more next year. We've got a lot of recruiting that's on the horizon. the recruiting piece had to be on hold until we knew when we were done playing. So I'll be out this week recruiting again, continuing to recruit, I should say, with the younger guys that we want to bring in. And then there's school, there's training still, there's still a lot to be done before next season.
Well, Coach, it's been a great season. We appreciate
thank you very much.
Coming in every week and talking with us. And we thank you for joining us in the Reb Zone. This is our final episode of the year. We're back in late August as we begin our football coverage. But for now, we leave you with the Runnin' Rebels plays of the year. Thanks for joining us. Good night.
Zone Sports Show was presented by RC Willie. Your home, your way.